Lilly and the Rusty Raconteur have emerged from the Many-Star Cloak Arcane Laboratory at Port Llast to find morning hasn't yet reached the sleepy little coastal village. They plan to visit every known merchant in town, except for Whaelgund Wheelrace Wagonworks, that is, which is just as well, as Lily's heard the owner, Stout the Jolly Whaelgund, never stops talking, laughing, or cracking jokes. Or here's the cracked anvil. Or singing, so ghastly the innkeep's sword even scare the black wolf himself away. The Cracked Anvil Blacksmith. Hard to miss with the cracked anvil out front. Why anyone would name their forge after a ruined piece of equipment is beyond Lilly. And she wonders how he gets any business at all.
Can I help you?
Welcome to the Cracked Anvil. I'm Haljal Throndor, and I reckon you're here to dither and bargain me right out of business, aren't you, stranger? Alright, ask you what he sells. Well, our selection of goods run the gamut, being as it were the general store for the good town of Port Llast. As well, my smith over there can show you a wider selection of weapons if you wish. Why don't you take a look yourself? Well, she has the opportunity, I think she'll ask a few questions. Sometimes I hear stories around about an area, sometimes I don't, though when I do, it's usually about a place like the Neverwinter Wood, Charwood, or even Luskin sometimes. Alright, ask him what news he's heard from Charwood. Nobody seems to know what's going on there. To be true, there hasn't been much coming from Charwood in quite some time. Perhaps it's for the better, too. I hear tell it's a spooky place. Alright. Ask him what news he's heard from Neverwinter Wood. Not a peep coming out of them woods. So far as I were to say, though, I haven't spoken with many who'd been through there. Alright, ask him what he's heard from Luskin. With the gates to the city sealed, there's not much word to be had, I'm afraid. Alright, he's got no news at all. Alright, ask him to see what he's selling.
They would likely be disguised and could be anywhere. As yet another pair of red leather boots, the ones blessed by priests of Shantico. If Lilly had to guess, she'd find nothing but red leather boots, sold by these traveling priests, all along the high road. From Luskin in the north through Waterdeep and even all the way to Baldur's Gate in the south. And a ring of scholars. Of course, she has a scholar's friend already, but, well, hers doesn't have a light. She can't resist trading for it, need for it or no. While trading, Haljal asks the Inquisitor General if she knows of a healer powerful enough to help him, exposing a crushed right arm, explaining that the damage was caused by a cave-in that also crushed his right leg and chest when he was only a young miner north of Mirabar. Lily's horrified, not only at the damage, but at such distaste to show her his crippled lame limb, as if it were a part of the stock, as if she cared a whit about his failings. She can't imagine how her holy defender could help him, and says so, plainly, and with obvious disgust. He sighs, explaining that if he ever does find one who can, he hopes to return. She interrupts, only to discover that the halfling admirer's gift ring is worthless, just as she thought. Now it at least makes sense why the owner doesn't smith himself.
Hail to ye!
Alright, here's the blacksmith for the cracked anvil. Greetings, Elvin. I be Haljal Smith. You need some arms or armor, and can I find what you likes in Haljal's regular stock? I may be able to help you. Alright, let's see what he has.
They would likely be disguised and could be anywhere. As yet more pairs of red leather boots. As Lilly runs her fingers over the soft leather, she stares at her own malformed manipulator. It's one of her only imperfections. though she's just glad it's not serious. Like one of the debilitating afflictions she's heard can affect those who conduct magical research. Some of her worst fears. Like Bertrek's amnesia. She'd have trouble remembering spells, but she wouldn't realize it until she actually attempted to cast one. At which point, she'd suddenly forget a crucial element. Or chronic incandescence. Even that horrible wild surge with red skin wasn't as bad. At least she didn't radiate light. Through her robes, even. Or Conjuritis, the bane of conjurers, obviously. She'd go to summon her dire spider and then suddenly, poof, some bizarre and unexpected effect, like summoning a plush toy dragon instead. Then there's Barlow's Blacksickness, the bane of necromancers. The casting of necromantic spells is accompanied by stomach cramps, blurry vision, or nausea. Some have even died, ironically enough. By a pile of stones, Lilly discovers a piece of quartz, a useful spell component. And of course, there's immaterialism, an affliction more common among illusionists. She'd simply fade away, until her body were transparent, making her appear as if she were made of glass. Finally, the druid she saw yesterday from atop the bluff.
Hello there to you. My name is Ballard. I'm looking for someone interested in a dangerous mission. Might you be interested?
That would probably depend on what he's offering, but sure, I think primarily came here to trade. Asking what he's proposing. There's been trouble over in the Neverwinter Wood of late. Started with travelers bringing back tales of normally peaceful animals attacking them for no reason. Of course, heard about this. Then farmers and woodcutters began to disappear. Animals have been attacking everyone, even the rangers and druids that are there to help the forest. I fear that without assistance, whole villages near the wood might be destroyed. Yeah, well, she might be interested in what's going on later if she discovers it has something to do with the cult. But not right now. People's lives are at stake. I hope you change your mind.
Welcome back. What can I do for you now?
Yeah, of course, this is why she came here, to see what he offered to sell.
They would likely be disguised, and could be anywhere, as one of two pairs of black leather boots, the ones commissioned by Aawill, the archdruid of the Neverwinter Woods Druid Grove, which is no longer so far away. Just east of town, actually. Ballard carries an interesting suit of leather armor, called the Great Oak, infused with protective energy against giants by a tree ant named Birch. After giants fell the grove of his oldest oaks, he vowed revenge, and enlisted the aid of a group of rangers, enchanting their armor. The suit here was among them. Ballard's grove seems to be just full of berry bushes. Normally, Lilly wouldn't stoop to apprentice's work, but the petty tyrant wants reagents to trade. Fenberries. Lily's not familiar with them at all, but imagines it's some kind of edible bilberry. Like huckleberry, hurdleberry, or even whortleberry. She can't help but wonder if the locals make a fenberry wine. Otherwise, seeing the berries here reminds her of a creature she read about in Elminster's Ecologies. Not Appendix IIIa from the Watchers Keep Temple West Library, but the volume proper. In the depths of the East Starwood of the Elven Forest Cormanthor, a few miles north of Halfaxe Trail, grows 100 acres of blueberry shrubs. Until they ripen, the berries are inedible, pale green and hard as stone. All that like fenberry, come to think of it. By late spring, however, the berries turn purple and swell to the size of watermelons. At one time, dozens of Shambly Mounds subsisted on these berries, thanks to their abundance and quality. But then, one starless summer night, a Cuadol spiraled from the sky and crashed into the berry field, where it died on impact. Although it appeared and smelled strange, it decomposed, was absorbed into the ground, and was soon forgotten. The following spring, however, the season's berries fell, unripened to the ground, and the entire crop was ruined. But not before some of the mounds ate from the infected field, causing their bodies to stretch until they resembled immense serpents. It's rumored that serpentine Shambly Mounds still dwell in the area, guarding their blueberry field from trespassers. Cows. Things that Lily likes and dislikes, in no particular order. Number 202. Cows. Dislike. She wonders if they're spoiled here, as Nessa was. Needless to say, the hoofed ones are ineffective weapons of the arcane. This mangy half-breed is lucky the Lady of Murder is feeling, weary. The point is, picking berries can be dangerous. Who knows? There could even be some foul creature guarding the fenberries in and around Port Llast. Maybe that's why the Black Wolf is here.
Do business to ya.
Nice to see people of quality in our town. Welcoming Lily to Port Llast.
Imagine that. A cursed wolf dies in the Druid's Grove of Neverwinter Wood, and its blighted corpse taints the fenberries. The denizens of the forest become were-creatures. Were-rabbits, were-mice, were-geese, were-deer, were-elk, were-moose, and, of course, were-druids. The most powerful among them, the were-archdruid Aawill, the Black Wolf himself. Local legend come to life.
Hi.
The boys were playing soldiers and thieves. Jimmy was playing Stirge the Baby Thief, but he couldn't think of any good riddles. Not sure Lily's heard of that game before.
Hello.
Who are you?
Stirge the Baby Thief. Perhaps the same Stirge for which Inquisitor General Black is searching, the Bulwark Prison escapee. Stealing babies. From the rich, if she had to guess. Though it hardly sounds like the workings of the smartest man alive, as the fool claims to be. Why, any old halfwit can snatch babes from a cradle. Here, by the South Road Gate, is a farmstead, with the dog by the door. It must be the Eisenfelts, Urth's parents. She will at least have a look about, you know, for wolf prints and the like.
Sorry.
Locked barn doors makes the Inquisitor General's inquiry difficult. Well, they'd be lying if she said she didn't feel a bit, well, uneasy. Even the moon is full. An empowered moon, as the Dusty Diviner would have said. Empowering for lycanthropes in particular. It looks like an interrogation of the parents is warranted after all. What could they be hiding? It could just be cows, of course, but you never know. They could be Fenberry eating were-cows, back from holiday in Neverwinter Wood. Confounded canine. She can only hope he'll... If she didn't need them for Eltoora, she'd feed him enough Fenberries to choke on.
The Eisenfeldt home is awfully quiet, and so are the parents, wearing worried frowns, apparently wondering where their son Urth might be. Go away. We don't want you bringing trouble on this house.
Hello.
Of course, this is the Eisenfeldt's, Urth's parents. Here's the husband. You heard the missus. Now move on.
Nobody tells the Inquisitor General to move on.
Even Lord Nash's spymaster said an investigation on her part would not be without merit. Cultists, weird creatures. She won't know whether they're unrelated for sure until she's conducted a full inquiry. Lily begins to look for tufts of hair or claw marks or if anything's been chewing on the furniture. Of course, that's very suspicious to Lily. A mysterious book. Something she doesn't understand. BioWare Corporation. Inquisitor General Black asks what's out in the barn, but the Eisenfelds refuse to answer. Very well. She bids her red-headed assistant to follow her upstairs. Oh, Urth, there's someone coming up. You look presentable, don't you, my boy? How pathetic. Protecting the boy, as if he were harmless. Sick with some common ailment like the flu and not lycanthropy. She's glad for the warning, though. And for the anti-lycanthropic goods, Lily takes a bit of belladonna and chews on a leaf. Urth had better be presentable for his own sake.